Good evening. You're listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, make sure you have pen and paper by your side, for we are going to take a leap. And I hope that you're capable of grasping, understanding what you're going to hear tonight. Going to try to educate you into what it is that the Illuminati really believes, or at least a part of it, anyway. Tonight's lesson is taken from Ancient Freemasonry, An Introduction to Masonic Archaeology by Frank C. Higgins. Please, ladies and gentlemen, pay very close attention, for some of these ideas are difficult to grasp. Some of them are based upon ancient myths and stories that have come down through the beginning of mankind over the ages to the present. What we are dealing with are ancient beliefs, ancient religions. Some of it is the truth. Some of it is metaphor for what man was not able to grasp or understand, and so he made up stories to explain it. Some of it, well, you listen. You be the judge and pay attention to the music you're going to hear tonight, because these beliefs are inculcated into the minds of the populace on a daily basis through television, through movies, through the things that you're taught in school. There is probably, ladies and gentlemen, no subject in the world so freely theorized about by those who know nothing whatever about it as Freemasonry. Many of you listening think you know something about Freemasonry. Some of you are Freemasons, and you don't know any more than anybody else. especially if you belong to the Blue Lodge. And the worst of it all is that the misguided critics are not always those who are supposed to be dwelling in outer darkness. Some of us, through our studies, have actually become illumined without stepping foot in a lodge. And by illumined, I don't mean buy into everything that they believe or say or plan, but understand it. Understand it sometimes better than most Freemasons ever will, no matter how long they remain in the lodge, no matter how many degrees they obtain. And anyone who wishes to learn the secrets that are being held by those who call themselves the guardians of the secrets of the ages may do so, because none of it is really hidden. You see, it's hidden by the fact that most people are too ignorant to understand that they have to study these things to understand their enemies or their friends, as the case may be. The Masonic Lodge is very much like one of those ingenious apartments devised to combat the high cost of living somewhere, in which, as a visitor, you are to all intents and purposes led to the parlor. Once the guest departs, the pressing of a few buttons and the sliding of a few panels turns every article of furniture into something else entirely, and the tired host is in an equally luxurious and well-appointed bedroom, invisible to the previous guest. A very large majority of Freemasons stay in the parlor all their lives. They don't even know that there are other rooms in the house. And they never discover the double purposes of the signs, the symbols, and the secret work which they think they understand. Where everything is veiled, and then it is reveiled in the next initiation. The poor sheeple thinks that reveiled means revealed. Study the spelling of the word. The very meaning of the word initiation is to open the eyes or reveal. That something which appears to be one thing is really another. That simple objects which we have never considered in other than a utilitarian sense may be employed by the instructed hand for far more noble and glorious purposes, are in some instances ignoble and dirty purposes. Up to the very point of his final acceptance into the fraternity, the candidate in Masonry may depend upon his sponsors and supporters to smooth the way for him to the utmost of their ability. But when he has at last attained the coveted goal and received the congratulations of the faithful friends who have rejoiced in his coming among them, the reason that he's really there, then commences the real test of his quality as a Mason, and he must study and secure information for himself. Most never do. What he might discover if he uses his intellect is that each time he goes through the initiation of a higher degree, the same story is told differently and ends up having a completely different meaning. But each time, the fool actually believes that he has now discovered the finally meaning. Usually, at the third degree, what's called the Master Mason. Not realizing, of course, that in the Scottish Rite there are another 29 degrees. And in the York Rite, not as many more, but still more degrees. Each time a different story is learned with a different meaning, always the same story from the beginning. There have been many forms of Freemasonry in the past because men of other days did not have Bibles on their altars or conduct their ceremonies in precisely the same manner as Freemasons of today, and it's no reason for repudiating them and claiming that their observances related to something else, because the Brotherhood has always been the same. It has existed under many different names and many different occupations, and that's why it is difficult for those who are easily deflected from their goal in research away from the path. And they say, well, it ends here, so it could not have stemmed from ancient times. It was started in this lodge in England, because they can't find anything before that that was known as Freemason. The thread that we have followed has not been the name, ladies and gentlemen, nor the occupation of Masonry, but the principles and ideals and beliefs and the hidden secret religion and the scientific bent of this group. And when you learn to conduct your research along those lines, the path stands out like a neon tube on the darkest night. And it is easy to follow, all the way back to the very beginning of human history, the Brotherhood has existed. If we are to do that, follow the thread, learn who these people are, what their bent is, what they believe, why they behave as they do, we must be diligent to make sure that we understand completely what it is that we discover. For to inject our prejudices and our beliefs into it is wrong. For I found that at some point they are right, at some point they are wrong. And at all points along the way, it has been used by the very, very clever to control the not so clever, with the promise of some secret hidden knowledge that really isn't there. There's proof that not one of the ancient operative grandmasters could have worked his way into a single modern lodge. They wouldn't have understood it, because much of the ancient method of initiation has been stripped away. You see, in ancient times, the goal of at least the beginning initiatory rites were to so threaten and so terrify the initiate that he experienced what is now called a near-death experience. The goal was for him to literally see the light. You'll understand what that means sometime later as I continue in your education. Many of you out there don't think that you need to know this, but I'm telling you right now, if you step upon a battlefield to face an opposing general and you do not know what he is thinking, what his tactics may be, what his religion is, how he is most apt to act or behave in a certain circumstance, you are in danger of losing that battle. King Solomon, or King Hiram of Tyre, would have had the time of their lives in obtaining admission anywhere. There could have been no Bible on King Solomon's altar, because the Book of the Law, or Old Testament, had been long since lost, only to be recovered sometime later by Hilkiah, the high priest, in the reign of Josiah. 2 Chronicles 34. And the New Testament, folks, had not yet been written, nor was it to be written for 13 or 14 centuries to come. In fact, instances might be multiplied to show that the true philosophy of Freemasonry is something far above and beyond many of its latter-day essentials. You see, most modern Freemasons don't really practice real Freemasonry. It's being used to inculcate beliefs and ideas to change the world. The true philosophy of Freemasonry is something far above and beyond many of its latter-day essentials, and you have to look for that which unites the ancient brothers to the modern brothers in things of much less apparent importance, but truly, folks, of greater weight than many, to which anyone gives impressive insistence. The fact that the soldiers of Caesar carried short swords, spears, bows, arrows, and bucklers did not make them any the less masters of military science. In fact, in their day, they were the penultimate of military success. In actual fact, modern military experts are astounded at the manner in which various strategic operations were carried out by the soldiers of ancient Rome. And they still respect their leaders as military geniuses, and their tactics and methods are studied in all of the military colleges of the world. So it is that the correspondences of modern Masonry reside in points which only the student ever perceives. Notice I said student, someone actively engaged in the profession of learning. And it is not exceeding the truth to say that the real student is translated by Freemasonry into a different world, completely from that on which the apathetic brother in the lodge is content to vegetate, and that is exactly what most of them do. We have just passed through a period of the world's history in which many and serious errors have been current about the world as it existed prior to 2,000 years ago. Most of the history is not history at all. It's fiction, it's fantasy, it's absolute invention. Our civilizations are different, folks, but the current notions of their improvement are far from correct. The true man is the naked human animal endowed by our Creator with a reasoning mind and an immortal soul. When he is dressed decently, whether in fig leaves, skins, a toga, or creased trousers, when he is fed so that his palate is delighted and his physical forces maintained, doesn't matter whether with fruits or nuts, game from the forest, or the refinements of La Cuisine Francoise, when wife and children evoke the tenderness of his being, when the ties of charity, friendship, and love bind him to his friends and family, and his soul reaches out in grateful recognition to an unseen but ever recognized cause, then man is as perfect as man will ever be, and always has been that perfect since he has been man, and that's the ultimate perfection that he can ever reach. Many of our modern contemplations of the self and the wonders of our own time seem to impel us to build unflattering contrast between ourselves and those who went before. You see, most of the accounts we read of the barbarities and brutalities of past ages are like Mark Twain's comment on the premature report of his death. And I quote Mark Twain, "greatly exaggerated," end quote. Unfortunately, folks, the Greeks of Alexander's time or the Romans of the Republican era, whose laws we still admire and in many instances copy, did not have accounts of the Kaiser, the Sultan, von Bissing, and von Tirpitz to show them how degenerate they were and how a few thousand years more or less were going to improve humanity. But we're able, on our side of the great gulf of time, to abandon some of our foolish notions and realize, while the outward aspects of human society have altered from age to age, man has remained essentially exactly the same, good, bad, and indifferent according to his lot, environment, and his moral values. Freemasonry takes very much the same view of the human race that I have just imparted to you. And it has maintained this view during the thousands of years in which it's been trying first to make what they call good men helpful, charitable, and just, and in second instance to make bad men better by placing such influence as themselves amongst them. This is what they're taught, but this is not what often occurs. And that's why true Freemasonry can never be a sectarian institution, folks, and why it is marred wherever sectarianism has set its seal. Masonry views the Creator as though there were not a single difference of opinion on religious grounds between any two men in the world, and that's why you'll find a Christian Bible on the altar of one Masonic lodge, a copy of the Quran on another altar of a Masonic lodge, a copy of the Torah on the altar, B'nai B'rith, a copy of the Bhagavad Gita in a lodge in Delhi, India. You see, wherever men differ on a Masonic foundation, the subject of their contention cannot be Freemasonry. It may be some innovation, a day or a thousand years old, but still not Masonry, for Freemasonry harks back to the beginning of mankind, before any of the topics upon which any of us dispute today were ever even heard of, ladies and gentlemen. Its signs, its symbols, its rituals are all saturated with the ancient wisdom, but they are explained in many cases by trivialities, so palpable that one must recognize that admission to Freemasonry, to the lodge, while testifying to the worthiness and qualification of the individual, according to them, by no means dispenses him from the necessity of progressing. But most of them never do. It's used as an elite club. And in many cities, if you're not a Freemason, you cannot succeed in business. It's like living in a Mormon town and you're not a Mormon. You will not succeed in business because Mormons will not frequent your business. And they'll tell you that if you join the church. Things will be much better for you. It is wrong of them to do this, but nevertheless, that's what they do. That's human nature. It's human nature. It's what you do in your own way amongst your friends and in your organizations and cliques. You see, I've discovered long ago, ladies and gentlemen, that what we call adult society is nothing more than high school society. The same games are played. The same cliques exist. You always have your socias and you always have your greasers. You got your jocks and you got your nerds. And everybody's trying to get into one clique or another and stay there and fulfill the expectations of those to whom they wish to be admired by. See, there's no such thing really as adults. They're just older children. All of us. Me included. The more I learn, the more I realize, the more I need to know, the more I understand that I will never live long enough to even begin to know or understand that which is necessary. But I cannot give up. I cannot quit. I must continue. For if I stop, the moment I stop, I become a slave again of someone or something or some organization. It is a never-ending, never-ceasing battle to be free, to be responsible, to be indeed sovereign in my own right. And some, it may be said, that the initiate only begins his mystical journey from the point at which he's raised to the right to undertake and pursue it. And remember, he's always raised by the grip of the lion's paw. Where does that come from? What is the lion's paw? Well, pay a little bit more attention to what's springing up around you. Don't you think it's very strange that at this point in history, well, Pat Robertson is standing there with this little insignia down in the lower left-hand corner of the television screen. It will be on your right as you face the television. The heraldry of the two lions rampant holding up the cross and the crown. And what is playing at the local theater, ladies and gentlemen? The Lion King. What is the Lion King? It is the representative symbolism, ladies and gentlemen. And you'll see it in Las Vegas. As millions of people walk between the protective paws of the great lion of the MGM Grand Hotel daily and don't understand its meaning. The lion is facing directly the Luxor, or the source of light. It is the symbolism of the royal family of the tribe of Judah, the descendants of the house of David, that will rule the New World Order. Freemasons don't even have the slightest idea what they are a part of or what they are helping to bring about. I stand back in awe as I watch this and study it. And as my knowledge increases and I have a better understanding, my jaw drops to my chest in amazement. Absolute amazement. I don't know if I'm going to be successful in waking up anyone, but I must continue to try. For you see, once we really understand what's happening in this world and what's bringing it about and why, and once we understand that we can never cease studying and understanding and learning, no matter how old we get or how smart we think we are, once we understand that, that's the only time in our history that we will actually be free, even though we thought we were free on many prior occasions. None of us are free yet. Nor have we ever been. We've been pretty close to it. But somewhere along the line, we stopped thinking, stopped using our brains, began to be puppets. Someone began to attach strings to our hands and our arms and our feet and our knees and our mouth even. It is amazing. On the physical plane, folks, Freemasonry is the science of sciences. The supreme recognition of God is the artificer of terrestrial nature. but not the God of the Bible. Even though they have a Bible on their altar, that is not the God that they worship. Not at all. In the series Star Trek, which music I played at the beginning of this program, and you'll hear again, Dr. Spock represented the illumined man, the man who worked from pure intellect. He was never wrong. And even though Captain Kirk was the commander of the starship Enterprise, it was Dr. Spock who really controlled everything. None of you really understood that. But someday, maybe you will. At some point in the near future, ladies and gentlemen, you will begin to see more manipulation, specifically of the economy. Most people don't look to precious metals anymore. They have, at this point, and I'm talking about most people, not all, been convinced that whatever is labeled money has worth, whether it does or not. They are never taught about money in school. They don't know how the economy is actually really controlled. They don't understand what a depression really is or what inflation is the result of. You're seeing gold and silver disappearing, but not into the hands of the general public. You also see that nations pay their debts with gold or silver. And when the new currency is put into place, I've already revealed to you that it will have two values, one within the country and one without. The one without will be based upon a standard amongst nations agreed upon by treaty, and it will be a gold standard. But in the country, eventually, gold and silver, possession of precious metals, will be outlawed, just as it has been done in the past. There will always be an underground market. There will always be a black market. Gold and silver will be the king on the black market. I perceive that at some future date, ladies and gentlemen, the stock market will plummet to depths that you will not understand. Many people seeing the value of their assets disappearing like cotton in the wind will then begin to buy up gold and silver as quickly as they can, and the price of gold and silver will elevate to heights you've never dreamed. The Illuminati, those who control the economies of the world, will open their vaults and dump the wealth that has been hoarded since the beginning of human history onto the market. And the value of gold and silver will drop to nothing. And all of you, in your second attempt to save something of what you've gained during your life, will then dump what you have in gold and silver on the market, and they will buy it all up for pennies, and you will be left with nothing. Those of you who are smart enough to buy gold and silver now and ignore the market, absolutely ignore it, whether it goes up or down, don't pay any attention to it whatsoever, If you can keep your gold and silver until everything stabilizes, you will be the king of the underground market. Call now, 1-800-289-2646. 1-800-289-2646. I understand these people, ladies and gentlemen. I know them intimately. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. You'll be glad that you did. In Star Trek One, the Federation had brought all the different known intelligences in the universe together in what could be called on Earth a new world order. They battled against one race that refused to join. They were called, ladies and gentlemen, the Klingons. Why were they called the Klingons? Because they were clinging on to the old way. If this life that we live now on this earth were a part of that mystical representation of the real world that we know as Star Trek, those of you listening to this broadcast would be the Klingons. On the spiritual plane, Freemasonry is the original religion. They claim that they are the religion of religions. To the public, they say they are a fraternal order, not a religion at all. They lie a lot. For someone who professes to be so good, bent upon such benevolent intentions for the world, they lie a lot. They believe there's a demonstrator of a deity who is to be loved and obeyed according to the highest dictates of the consciences of all mankind. The learned teaching the illiterate, the strong helping the weak, the clear of sight leading the blind, and this entices so many people into the lodge. But at the highest levels, no. No. And no. If you watched all the episodes of the movies Star Trek, beyond the series on television, for the movies attempted to put all that the television series had attempted to foist upon the unsuspecting sheeple of the world that watched it, condensed it all into these movies. And even the number of movies that were made is significant in the occult meaning of the numerology of those who call themselves illumined. Now, I talk about Freemasonry here. I'm really talking about all of the different lodges under the different names and occupations that make up at the highest levels. Those we call the Illuminati. Illuminati just means, simply, the collective body of those who are illumined. It's very simple. Very, very simple, ladies and gentlemen. And in one memorable episode, you will see that they actually went out to find God. God. And they went beyond what was called the barrier, where you're not supposed to go. Nobody ever went beyond this barrier before. And of course, it represented the separation between the material and the spiritual world. They transcended this, went beyond it. Most of you never understood any of this. You sit there and watch these movies as if they're really meant to entertain you. You're being brainwashed. You're being educated into the new world religion, and you don't even know it. And they reached this planet where God lived. God actually lived on a planet. That should have been your first clue that something was wrong. When they got down to that planet, strange things began to happen. The power of God was revealed to them, and they were told to kneel in the presence of God. And what happened? Old Kirk always comes up with this barrel full of guts at the most inappropriate times. What does he do? He challenges God. Kirk was Job. Kirk was Job. He challenged God. And what did he do? He won. He won. And what was the message? The message is that in a confrontation between man and God, man is the more powerful. Therefore, ergo, man is God. How many of you got that message? I bet there's going to be a run on video rental stores tomorrow, the likes of which they have never experienced before. Their history and the videos of the episodes of the movie Star Trek will disappear off the shelves. As you backtrack and try to understand the real meaning of those films. And I hope that you're successful, ladies and gentlemen. I really do. It's for this reason, folks, that Freemasonry, the Illumined Ones, under whatever their name, Alchemy, the Rose and Cross, the Knights Templar, Freemasonry, it doesn't matter what you call it, it's all the same. It's for this reason that it swept all over the world. At the dawn of civilization, overturning all barriers and leaping all frontiers. And if you want to see how successful they've been, there's another movie that they made, laughing at you. Go get a movie called They Live and watch it. The only man in the world who can see and understand what's happening has a pair of magical glasses. When he puts them on, he can see the reality of what's going on and interpret the symbology. That's me. That's me, folks. I'm all alone out here trying to wake the rest of you up. And like the man in the movie, he goes around trying to get people to understand this, to explain to them what's happening, get them to try on the glasses so that they can see. He is, of course, attacked, ostracized, discredited. But like me, he never stops. Get it? Watch it. Every locality has produced its individual dogmas, but the doctrine of universal brotherhood was carried throughout the world ages before the coming of temples or churches based upon the ascertainable facts of our universe. which could be demonstrated as clearly to one race of earth dwellers as to another. I've dwelt a lot upon the Masonic mysteries during this broadcast. The many tapes of the Mystery Babylon series that many of you have purchased and have had your eyes opened and are on the way to becoming truly knowledgeable. But I've dwelt a lot upon these mysteries of the Eastern world. But I've only touched upon the fringes, folks, of a contemplation which overspread the forests, hills, and dales of primitive Europe ages before the covetous eyes of any Caesar had remarked its glories and its possibilities. And there's no doubt whatever to be entertained that the mysteries of the ancient Celts, the Northmen, the Britons, and the Gauls were derived from the same Oriental sources as Freemasonry. An illimitable time prior to that period at which European history begins with the invasions of trained cohorts from what is now known as the Italian Peninsula. And that's where the occult influence begins to make itself felt amongst those who claim that they are the superior race. And all races claim that they're the superior race, but these are particularly persistent. And whether these mysteries entered Europe with the first errant nomads of the great wandering upon European soil from northern India, or whether they were imported thither and yon, as they would have said back in early England, by the merchants of the Mediterranean who traded in every port from India to Britain. It's not known. Nobody really knows. But I've studied Celtic archaeological remains, especially the rude coins of some of the tribes inhabiting the north of France just prior to the Roman conquest in the parts of Spain contiguous to Punic settlements. And those coins are able to attest to the fact that the symbolism of Egypt degenerated into an archaic form, but still unmistakable, as the symbolism of Egypt is present throughout. The one deity or god common to Egypt, Syria, Phoenicia, and the semi-barbaric peoples of northwestern Europe is represented by a figure that can be traced all the way from the last mentioned territory to farther India, and is that which is termed, according to locality, the Syrian god Baal, the Egyptian Bes, and the Indian Bacchus, otherwise known as Dionysus, are, to some, Dionysius. The last name is derived from the Semitic Adon-Ishu. Adon-Ishu, which the Babylonians corrupted into Dunyush, calling the capital of the valley of the Euphrates Tin-Tir-Ki, or place of the tree of life, and the country around about it Kar-Danish, or the garden of Danish, in which was placed, ladies and gentlemen, the drama of our first parents. You remember them, don't you? Adam and Eve. You see, among the Babylonians, this Ishu was the son of the god Anu, which literally means I am. Elizabeth Clare Prophet is familiar with that phrase, I am. She doesn't know what she's doing either. And his wife, Anatu. The word Adon meant Lord. Lord. In the Hebrew, you're familiar with Adonai. The word Adon meant Lord, which is identical with the word Baal, which also means Lord. The Hebrews originally called Jehovah Baal, quite reverently, and still call him Adonai, which means Lord. The Babylonian Bel and the Greek Adonis were the same as the foregoing, as also Dumuzi or Tammuz, throughout Syria. Remember, Tammuz was the son of the mystical union between the dead Nimrod and his wife Semiramis. Later it was Horus, the progeny of the mystical union between Isis and the dead Osiris. Throughout Syria, and Osiris, Horus, and Egypt, the manifest idolatry of these imageries is not to be gainsaid, but they are one and all the same. And they are one and all associated with symbols which upon dissection prove always to be geometrical or arithmetical concealments of the Hebrew four-lettered name J-H-V-H that many of you call Yahweh or Jehovah. The identification, folks, of this figure as that of the God of nature was made by symbolic attributes. The panther skin, above all, which is present in highly artistic form in Greek art, is barely indicated by a tail to the rude figures of the Syrians, Phoenicians, and Celtic tribes. All with the same thread of the same religion, all beginning at the same point in history. This was the god of the mysteries par excellence, from the Himalayas to the English Channel and even beyond. So far as the Celtic tribes penetrated into England, Wales, and Ireland, they brought this mystery religion with them. They built their temples, their lodges, of which Stonehenge is one. And they practiced their form of Freemasonry, oh yes, in those lodges. There was that vast Celtic priesthood, which went under the name of the Druids, and it's still one of the most completely misunderstood institutions, of which mention descends to us from that dim past. Our knowledge, folks, of them is derived from commentators who, while they were fairly keen observers, did not go farther than surface indications. And I have never seen, noticed before, they described the secret mysteries of the Druids in the depths of all but impenetrable forest, to which no profane, that's you, were admitted on any possible pretext. All of which, folks, looks as if imagination had done the principal work in the recorded descriptions, and that's closer to the truth than anything, for most of it is fiction, fable, myth, and some outright lies. And many take these lies, myth, fiction, and twist it to fit their own agendas and create more lies and more fiction. A good analytical observer, Reuben Barrow, in his Asiatic Researches, ventured to state that the Druids were purely and simply Brahmins. Brahmins. From the country that we now know as India. Their name is said by Oliver to be derived from the Greek word drus, an oak. And it is true that several Celtic terms for oak tree are closely akin to this. For instance, deru, D-E-R-W, was oak in ancient British, and Deru, in the closely allied American language of Brittany, whence Derwyden, or priests of the oak, would have been derived. But Druid, spelled D-R-U-I-D-H, also means a wise man, or magi. Magi. That's important. When you get into this UFO crap, it even becomes more important, and it brings us closer. Like the latter, the Druids were at once the philosophers, magistrates, and priests of their people. They were the Illuminati of their day, uniting the entire range of learned professions under one head. Strabo is the authority for the assurance that the Druids practiced the Samothracian, Cabriac mysteries. And another Greek classic writer affirms that they were addicted to the worship of Bacchus. and their ceremonies took place in a grove, in an outdoor temple of the sun, where there was a symbol of a phallus, and always a pool of water to reflect the light, much like Dealey Plaza, where Kennedy was assassinated, in the symbology of the grove on Elm Street. Later, you were all entertained by a series of movies called Nightmare on Elm Street. But, of course, you don't make these connections because you have no background of education to understand what it is that you're being bombarded with, or what it is that you're actually walking in when you walk in Dealey Plaza in Dallas. Dr. A. Borlasi, writing of the Druids early in the 19th century, has traced many similarities which connect the Brahmins with the Persian and Chaldean magi, and the latter with the Druids. Hutchison says that there were two sects of Druids, one of which was composed of Sabians, or star worshippers, and the other of fire worshippers, the philosophers of fire, akin to the Parsis, and that these two hated each other cordially. Well, there's little doubt that the Cymric or Welsh god Hu was the same god as the Semitic Ehu or Jehovah. And the Cymri are traceable in their wanderings clear across Europe from their original homes in Asia Minor. The Druids worship the deity under the form of the equinoctial bull, as did the early Hebrews and Egyptians, and under the form of an erect monolithic stone, the phallus, the hermetic pillar, or Gilgal, of which so many are found in Palestine to this day. The Ceridwen, the female consort of Hu, responds in every way to the Egyptian Isis, and they had a solar god called Isus, or Jesus, our Jesus, who corresponded with Horus and was celebrated with similar rites. The latter is evidently the old Babylonian Ishu in another dress, and it is the basis, or the font, from which British Israelism stems, and it's all bullshit. Good night, folks. God bless you all. I will continue this tomorrow night.